Fantastic. Comes from downtown Cape Town. A downtown with a difference, because just 8 years ago, this was a purely industrial dock. Millions and millions of pounds of investment later, this has quite simply become one of South Africa's biggest tourist attractions. Welcome to the waterfront. From Cape Town, we then go up country and follow the sun to Sun City, where Lucy Vandenbroel shows you more than she intended. And if that's put you in the holiday mood, would South Africa's shocking crime statistics put you off? Martin Frizzell talks to the English woman who's had enough and is packing up to go home. But I can assure you that we are going absolutely nowhere. We are staying here right through to 8:45 this morning. And also, Fiona, I should say to you that the waterfront will also be known to people for all the wrong reasons, because of two terrorist attacks. One last August, an outrageous bomb explosion on Planet Hollywood, and another bomb explosion, a car bomb, on New Year's Day. And the security situation is something which I know concerns not only people, of course, who live here, but people at home who wish to relocate here or travel out here on holiday. And the security situation is something we're going to talk about today, because, as I said at the start of the week, we're going to look at all mixes of life out here.
Good, and as you say, Eamon, a lot of people will be interested in that. Lots of people have been phoning in wanting to see the other side. We've seen the sun, we've seen the wonderful sights. Eamon will be back with us in about 1/4 hour. There he is on the waterfront, like a young Marlon Brando, it looks like. We're live from front with Marlon Brando. There he is there. Morning to you.
No. You see, if you worked out here, you would be in the movies. You would be treated like a movie star. Now, what am I talking about here?
I have no idea.
Showtime, and it's live. So you have to be right off the mark first time. Be part of the glamorous world of television and move seamlessly from talking about the latest Hollywood gossip to in-depth political interviews. What am I talking about, Fiona? I am talking about breakfast television. Fiona, this is you and me here in South Africa. Yeah. This could be us. Yeah. This, and they're treated like real, real stars out here.
They look
really
happy
are,
as well, great big smiles on their faces.
Jeremy and Nothambo.
Yeah.
Yes, and what I've arranged, Fiona, is that because it's just, I've realised it's so much nicer getting up in the sunshine than in the dark and the cold, and I'm going to try and arrange a little bit of a job share, a job swap out here, okay?
Hey, that's a good idea.
But also, if you're in the holiday mood, that's a very good idea, yeah. Mm-hmm. After the break, we're going to show you this lovely hotel. This is the Table Bay Hotel here in Cape Town. It's 5-star. We're going to talk a bit about that, and we're going to whisk you off to the Las Vegas of South Africa. That's Sun City, right after this.
Eamon Out of Africa, in association with South African Airways.
Tell you what, if you do visit Cape Town, you could do a lot worse than stay here. The magnificent Table Bay Hotel, 5-star, probably the premier hotel in Cape Town, dominated here in the forecourt, the garden here, by Oscar. Oscar apparently is a big seal who was very well known in the harbour here down through the years. And judging by some of the names on this monument, these plaques here, some of these people could have picked up Oscars in their time. Quincy Jones, Michael Jackson here, Wesley Snipes, all these people have stayed here. Boris Becker, Michael Schumacher, Mia Farrow here, Versace, Imran Khan, Naomi Campbell. And, you know, those are just some of the names. They've got to be looked after. People of this stature, when they come here, the man that does it is not a South African. He's an Irishman from Galway. His name's Chris Noon, and he's guest services manager. Chris, nice to see you. Good seeing you. What is the secret of looking after big stars like this?
Well, obviously, stars are very temperamental. They can be in that, so one has got to really look after them in that. And privacy for them and confidentiality is one of the main things that they want in that. You know. Security is partly there, but as long as we give the service and give the standard, that's what they want.
Now, what about the more famous ones? I mean, what sort of requests have they made?
Well, I suppose, you know, they all have their own little quirks and everything else. But I suppose Michael Jackson, who's been on a number of occasions to our hotel, and that's, you know, he lives in the big suite on the top, you know, and he likes jelly babies, he likes Smarties, he likes crayons to draw at night, and that loves games.
So all those stories are true?
Yes, those are true.
And he just doesn't ask for a single bed or anything, he gets the works.
He gets the works. He gets the top suite in the hotel. It's called the Lion's Head Suite, and that, which overlooks the bay and the whole thing.
Now, when you're overlooking the bay, I mean, do you ever pine to go across the sea again to Ireland?
Yes, of course, Ireland is my home and that, but I love Ireland, but not the weather.
Not the weather, absolutely right.
Chris, you've also worked in Sun City.
Yes, Sun City is a 2 hours drive from Johannesburg, and that it's the Las Vegas of South Africa. Two very famous golf courses there, and that, you know, gambling is also there. And we stage $1 million every year. Yeah. They're the top 12 players in the world. Won this year again by Dickie Price, and that's against Tiger Woods in a playoff.
And the South African Open starting here today as well. Ernie Els, big hero here as well. Big hero with us, Lucy Vandenbroek in Sun City. Chris, thank you.
Lying on the edge of the Kalahari Desert, 100 miles northwest of Johannesburg, is the crater of an extinct volcano, this little green oasis in the middle of the parched bush. But I'm not here to look at the wildlife today. I'm here to check out Sun City. Once famed for its huge casinos, the modern-day Sun City boasts a host of other attractions. But be warned, nothing is what it seems. The bridge is actually shaking here. I could be in the middle of an earthquake, except I know that it's all completely safe.
So is this. And that.
And even this, a beach made from hundreds of tons of imported sand, washed every month to keep it gleaming. In fact, although it all looks ancient, nothing here is much over 20 years old. The entire place has been built from scratch. Over 1.5 million plants were shipped in to create this, a rainforest ecosystem which is now entirely self-sustaining. Also one of the world's few resorts to boast not one but two championship golf courses. This is the 13th hole,
which has a water hazard with a difference.
It may be the last thing you'd expect to find in the middle of a desert, but there's certainly no shortage of water here. If the waves of the man-made beach don't do it for you, there's always the lake for something a little more energetic. The rivers and lakes alone here at Sun City have been filled with 23 million litres of water, and I'm likely to swallow a fair few litres going down this, but here goes. I don't think I can do this. And I'm likely to swallow a fair few going down this, but here goes.
So, Sun City, one big attraction. Lucy Vandenbroek, two big attractions. Fiona.
What am I supposed to say to that? Yeah. You've rendered me speechless for once in your life, Eamon Holmes. Mm. Looks lovely day. In fact, we've had a few calls in this morning saying, when are we going to see Sun City? Well, you got more than you bargained for, didn't you? And we will be back with Eamon in 10 minutes' time now. But with the time at 7:21 over here, you know what time that usually is? Some days of the week, it's time to catch up with all the Hollywood gossip.
And I knew what was happening, but it was just through what I sort of read in books, and I don't know, I never felt very threatened. I can't say that I did.
Well, okay, unfortunately, a lot of people here are threatened. A good experience for you. Deborah, we'll say goodbye to you and just tell people that live from South Africa right after the break, we are visiting the crime capital here, which is Joburg. Martin Frizzell has been to speak to one woman from Manchester who now says, because of crime, enough is enough for her. She's packing her bags and going home. During my stay this week, I came across statistics that are advertised in the front of newspapers that were on the news programmes here, which, quite honestly, on first sight, I thought were wrong. And they said that in South Africa last year, 18,000 people died violent deaths. That is the statistic. That is the situation with crime here. Is it out of control? Martin Fazell went to Johannesburg, which is regarded as the crime capital. Here's his report.
First, the good news about crime in South Africa. It's leveled off. It's not getting much worse. The bad news, it's still astonishingly high. And visitors to Johannesburg, its most cosmopolitan city, are more likely to be victims than anywhere else.
Everyone here has their own criminal anecdote. These minibuses, for instance, might as well have bullseyes painted on them because they are prime targets for carjackers. Last time I was here a few years ago, I managed to have one for just an hour and a half before it was stolen. This time round, my hotel room was burgled last night. Our sound man Barry here, he's been hijacked. His home's been burgled twice. Now, South Africa's own statisticians have found that of the 25 most civilized countries in the world, South Africa has the world's worst crime record.
In Johannesburg's suburbs, high walls are the fashion, 15 to 20 feet tall. With a murder rate 10 times that of Britain's, the residents have taken to compound life, protected by armed guards. High unemployment and low police wages are blamed, but crime has almost become endemic. Paula Jarrett, who moved here from Manchester 23 years ago, has been mugged, robbed, and carjacked. She's had enough. The Jarretts are leaving this apartment block and returning to England.
There's not one person that I know having either spoken to or have a relative or friend who something hasn't happened to. It's become such a common occurrence.
You're painting a vision of a nightmare here.
I mean, why does this have to be accepted? And a lot of British people I work with, you know, for British Airways at in the catering department, he was just telling me, tell it like it is. Let them know what's really going on.
A growing trend is carjacking. 13,000 in South Africa last year. This is the extreme protection on offer.
It's brand new, but if you look at the hijack rate at the moment, it'll definitely be used soon.
It's gone too far for Mandela's political opponents. Every week now, they protest outside the high walls of his Johannesburg home. Mr. Mandela's protection is up front.
In front of the president's house.
I know.
But just to have
it's a public road, I would have thought.
The crime situation in South Africa is so bad that basically we're living as hostages. You know, the innocent people, the law-abiding citizens, are actually hostage to a small bandit of criminals.
Well, I mean, Mr. Mandela, as he's at home just now in the house behind us, he's not done enough, obviously. I mean, what does he have to do to help people like yourself?
The army's been called in to help with the registration of voters for the 1999 election. And I would think that because we're living in this uncertain time, that's the sort of thing, that's a measure that needs to be taken by the government.
We need to call the army onto the streets.
Get the army onto the streets.
Paula Jarrett is not the only Briton getting out. This removal firm is shipping 50 families a month back to Britain.
We're going to have a change of lifestyle, I appreciate that. We've resigned ourselves to the fact that we'll be able to sleep at night and breathe easier.
Okay, well, that's the situation in Johannesburg. Here in Cape Town, we're 2 hours flying time south from Johannesburg. Duncan Clute is responsible for all this area you see around us here, the commercial activities. There are cinemas here, there are theatres, there are hotels, the massive shopping malls, all sorts of things, Duncan. And the thing is, two bombs planted here in the past 6 months. One last August, Planet Hollywood, and one on New Year's Day at your shopping mall. They sent these pictures all around the world and they sent negative images. Now, what have you done since to restore tourist confidence here?
All right, we are busy upgrading all our security systems once again. I think if you look at our figures insofar as normal crime is concerned, if you can call crime normal, we had no incidents specifically over December. We had over 2.7 million people, and we had no incidents. So I think our security systems, insofar as crime is concerned, is working extremely well. When we talk about urban terrorism, obviously we need to reevaluate and relook at everything we've got to make it as difficult as possible.
I know you're undertaking high-profile measures. I mean, just down there on the waterfront, we see mounted policemen. Very high profile, security cameras in evidence, police searches in and out of this whole complex, but yet I saw newspaper headlines this week which said that of the 20 million visitors you had here last year, which I think makes you South Africa's biggest tourist attraction, that is down to a trickle now over these months over Christmas.
I think we've also got to look at it in perspective. You know, normally at this time of the year, we do have a drop in people due to the school holidays being over and people spending all their money over December. So we have the phenomena of the normal drop in people this time of the year, but obviously the latest incident has affected our visitorship.
Would you walk through Cape Town on your own?
During the day, obviously, yes. I think during the evening, a person should be careful and normally walk in a group of two or three people and not be on your own.
Okay, that's the advice, Dr. Clute. Thank you very much indeed. Know where you're going and don't go alone. Back to London.
Eamon, thank you very much indeed. The other side of South Africa there from Eamon. We are live from South Africa, live from London too this morning. Coming up later on, when this late
morning to you. Cape Town is the scene. The temperature's 30 degrees. This is Dockside Cape Town. Welcome to the waterfront.
Yes, we got a white hour cruise to Seaport.
Away from the waterfront, we join a crack branch of the South African police force as they wage a war on domestic violence against
baboons.
And Ladysmith Black Mambazo take their Sounds of Africa to the streets here in the heart of Cape Town.
Okay, those are just some of the items between now and a quarter to nine. The waterfront, unfortunately, known in Britain and in many other parts of the world because of two terrorist bombs in the past few months. And although it has a very holiday atmosphere here today, the authorities are determined to make sure that everyone is safe. Very high-profile policing. Just look at this chap down here. Mounted police, very much in evidence. There are armed police ringing this whole complex, and a magnificent complex it is. Cinemas, theatres, hotels, restaurants. It all happens here, hustle and bustle, and the idea is to keep the tourists happy. We're broadcasting live, and we'll see you throughout the morning. Back to you, Fiona.
Thank you very much, Eamon. Live from South Africa this morning, live from London. We'll be back with Eamon in 10 minutes. From this end of the pond, wherever you are, girls, please come home. That's a plea from the heart. People informed.
You do. Well, Fiona, as if the temperatures weren't warm enough for us here, the warmth of the welcome I'm receiving out here is absolutely tremendous. Made all the warmer by all these lovely people from Britain who have turned up various parts, who have turned up to see us on our various locations. Oh, dear, quiet, please. This is a very posh hotel. I told you could come in if you were quiet. Five-star hotel this is. This lady, Caroline Budd, we met her earlier in the week, and South Africa and the broadcast, Caroline, we've been doing here, have created such an interest back home. A lot of people not only interested in coming here for holidays, but also coming to live, to relocate. And that's what you did 3 years ago.
That's right.
So why did you pack everything up? What did you fall in love with?
Well, I came out here to shoot a TV commercial, actually, for an ad agency I was working for. And I decided after I'd done the shoot, I ought to come down to Cape Town just to check it out for 3 days. Spent three magical days here. I didn't know a soul. But I went home and I resigned and packed my bag and off I came.
Now, you came out and you bought yourself a lovely house. We're going to see it now. Now, what was that house? Was it a good bargain to buy something that looks like this?
Yeah, I mean, the rand was particularly weak against the pound, and I sold my flat in London. I had a one-bedroom flat in Borough.
Yeah.
And then I bought this place with my better half out in Hout Bay.
Excellent. Now, people want to know, how easy is it to relocate? What have you got to do?
Well, I mean, I think a lot of it is really kind of guts. You've just got to kind of decide you want to do it and go for it. And I don't think it's not really that difficult on a practical level. I mean, I was fortunate enough to get a job here before I came out, so I had a sponsor. So I could get a temporary work permit out in South Africa, which I had for 2 years. And now I've got permanent residence after 2 years, which is quite a sort of natural progression. And now I can stay here working in the same kind of field.
And are you not tempted to go home?
No, I mean, I just love the lifestyle here, and I'm living in, I think, probably the most spectacular place in the world.
Ooh, hey. Well, let me ask you, have you ever been interfered with by baboons, attacked or burgled
your house? I have had a little instance with a baboon down at Cape Point, but nothing too serious.
Well, a lot of people, they are the big intruders here. We talked about crime. You said you're not worried about your personal safety here. Different people approach it in different ways. A lot of people are very happy with their lot. But baboons are a big problem, and we're up to some monkey business right after this break.
In association with South African Airways.
Good to see you again, GMTV, live out of Africa on this Thursday morning. Very big on their wildlife in South Africa. A lot to see, a lot to do, not just in the game reserves. We went on a sort of drive on Sunday afternoon, and we went down to Cape Point, to a place called Buffalo's Bay, and there are beaches and things down there, lovely breakers hitting the side of the rocks, whatever it is, but you are, well, bothered, pestered with these sort of baboons. Now, I mean, there was I inside the van, ready to go outside and photograph these baboons, but instead we sent our friend Martin out, Martin the cameraman, brave lad that he is, he went out there and faced them, and I sat in the comfort of the van filming Martin, filming the baboons, which really was the right way to do it, because, I mean, just say something had happened to me. Just say something had happened to you, Martin, hey? But that was it. They interfere with picnics, they do all sorts of things, and they're round and about the place. Scary sort of animals. But with me now is a man called Sean Boddington, and Sean works for the equivalent of the RSPCA back in the United Kingdom, and that's the SPCA, Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, that's here. Great. And Sean is going to talk over these pictures that you're about to see now. Now, what you see here is basically a police raid. This looks at first sight like a real sort of SWAT team, a terrorist attack, moving in there to apprehend some sort of criminal. But then we begin to see that the criminal involved, Sean, is in fact a baboon.
That's right. It's actually a renegade baboon from a troop of baboons that comes from the Cape Peninsula. These baboons, unfortunately, are geographically isolated from other troops, and because of urban development, they've had to sort of move off in different directions, and quite often they get into residential areas.
Well, we can see from these pictures the baboon is in the house. I mean, it's causing havoc in there.
Unfortunately, yeah. You know, the baboon's out of its own area. It's very nervous. There's a lot of nervous people around, a lot of barking dogs, cars, police. It was actually pandemonium on that particular day, and we managed to dart the baboon successfully and remove it back to its troop, which is what we intended doing.
Now, I must say, when we went to Buffalo's Bay, I did not like them around the place. It wouldn't have been my sort of scene. Now, you personally have come in contact with a baboon, and this baboon has become very famous. This baboon was called...
We had Bobby. He was
Bobby
the baboon.
Bob, would you hear the story about Bobby the baboon? Tell me what happened.
Well, Bobby unfortunately got into many dangerous situations. He nearly got knocked over once or twice. He got into a schoolroom full of screaming girls. And from there, we managed to trace him to a small wooded area just one side of Wynberg, which is actually a very residential area.
Yeah.
And from there, we had to dart him, and it took 4 or 5 darts. Unfortunately, Bobby, I think due to the stress and due to the sedative, didn't make it.
Right, but the story doesn't end there. Bobby didn't make it, but revenge came in the form of Bobby's mates.
Well, this was our greatest fear, and one day in Simonstown, I was sitting in my living room, and we had about 35 baboons coming through Simonstown, which is almost unheard of. You know, it's a case where I think the residents were so shocked, the baboons were so shocked, that again, it was a bit of pandemonium. But eventually the guys managed to chase the baboons up the mountain and safely, and they haven't returned.
They came and tracked you down. The moral of the story is, don't mess with the baboons. Okay, Sean, thank you very much indeed. Come this way with me. As we can see here, this is Oscar the seal. He's a bit of a landmark around here now. But with this baboon, this is Pat O'Neill. Hello, Pat.
Hello.
But don't mind if I stay this far away, Pat. Okay. But this is your little baboon. You're from Britain, Pat, and you've moved out here to look after baboons. Are they much maligned animals?
Yeah, well, they're absolutely wonderful animals. Very affectionate, very intelligent, and all the human emotions. and I've got 19 rescued baboons, all from shot and poison. This is from a poisoned, the troop were poisoned.
Really?
And he was the only, she was the only survivor.
Well, God bless you, Pat, and good luck to you with your work. And it's, you've got the wee baboon there on your knee, and something that you'll have to get used to, Fiona, is this little baboon has got a real nappy on, a little pamper, hasn't it, just so there's no little accidents. And that's the sort of thing, Fiona, if I can give you a tip, as a father of three, can I just say to you, never put a little toddler on your knee without taking a little precaution like that, okay?
It's gorgeous. You know, my heart goes baboon, baboon, baboon every time I set eyes on you, Eamon Holmes. Which will be in the next quarter of an hour's time. Thank you very much indeed. We're pressing on live from South Africa, live from London this morning. Later in the programme is on the water, not in it. Morning, Eamon, where is he? Oh, he's cruising there somewhere.
Here.
Oh, I can see here. You know what my eyesight's like.
Goodness sake. These are the big cruise boats, Fiona, that go out to places like Robben Island, and they see things like whales out there. So many whales in the South Atlantic waters, very close by, and your good hubby has been out hunting them. Well, hunting them through binoculars and things, looking at them, and we're going to be doing that tomorrow. Also, we've got a party on the beach, Fiona. We started the week in Bloberg Beach, Bloberg Strand, and we're back there tomorrow. Real carnival atmosphere for that. And we've got Matthew Marsden, remember him from Coronation Street, Chris the mechanic.
Gorgeous.
Oh yes, that's him. Well, he's going to be here and on the beach. Hopefully if it goes according to plan, he'll be in his togs. But he's launching a new pop career. Obviously he's had a record out before. He's recording a new pop video. We'll be talking to him tomorrow. And we leave you today, Fiona. I will say goodbye to everybody. See you on the beach tomorrow with the sounds. You can hear them there in the background. Ladysmith, Black Mambazo. See you in the morning. Don't you want to go there? Sadly, we have to leave South Africa for today. Eamon said, though, as you heard, he'll be back tomorrow with Matthew Marsden, amongst others. I've been dancing around my kitchen all this week, actually, to Ladysmith, Black Mambazo, since we've been doing this. At the